So next topic is formamidine insecticide. See, this formamidine neonicotinoid and natural products, they are very commonly used ectoparasiticide that comes under insecticide. And this insecticide or ectoparasiticide, we study this under chemotherapy also. So in chemotherapy also, we are going to study this ectoparasiticide, where we are going to study, apart from these groups, we are going to study ivermectins and juvenile growth hormones. So those things we will not discuss in the toxicology section. So anyhow, we are going to deal it in the chemotherapy. So the important ectoparasiticides are dealt here with. So the first one is the formamidine insecticide. So it is a novel group of insecticide. So when I was studying in the third year, that time also it was novel group. Since the book has not been updated, so it remains the novel group of insecticide. So it is the first insecticide group which acted, which mechanism of action was on the adrenergic system. So it is the first insecticide. And the very important prototype insecticide under formamidine insecticide is very commonly used, Amitraz. So Amitraz, as you know, it is an insecticide, acaricide, very commonly used as against the mites, also against the ticks and fleas. So I think it's commonly used against demodicosis. So used as a spray, dip, pour on preparation is there, flea collar is there, spot on is also there. So in arses, it is very rarely used. Indeed, it's not preferred in arses only. So rather it is contraindicated in arses, Amitraz. So chemically, Amitraz, it is called as N-methyl bis 2,4 xylyl imino methyl amine. So this is chemical name of Amitraz. So susceptibility wise, I told you arses are more susceptible. Indeed, they are contraindicated in arses than birds, fishes, and also the dogs and cat, preferably the young ones, are more susceptible. Then the mechanism of action, I told you the first insecticide to act on the adrenergic system. So it is an agonist of alpha 2 receptor. So what is the uniqueness about alpha 2 receptor? I told you the uniqueness about alpha 2 receptor is it is an auto inhibitory receptor. So it is an auto inhibitory receptor. So whenever there is stimulation of alpha 2 receptor, there will be a feedback mechanism. It decreases the release of the noradrenaline. So when it is the agonist of alpha 2 receptor, where it will decrease the release of neurotransmitter, it will decrease the release of neurotransmitter right in the CNS only. It decreases the CNS sympathetic flow. So it decreases the noradrenaline release from the CNS itself. So when it does so, so there will be decrease in the respiratory depression, there will be CNS depression, coupled with there will be cardiovascular disturbance, right? The important center that regulates the respiration and the cardiovascular system, so it is very closer to the sympathetic outflow. So when there is decrease in the sympathetic outflow, obviously there will be respiratory depression, cardiovascular collapse. Along with that, there will be CNS depression, because this noradrenaline and adrenaline, they are involved in increasing the mood or increasing the excitement level in the brain. So whenever there is decreased sympathetic outflow, there will be CNS depression. So yes, CNS and cardiovascular system are more affected in formamidine insecticide. In the clinical signs, in the acute toxicity, there will be predominant CNS depression. Then there will be sedation, incoordination, ataxia, disorientation. See, very commonly you might see this Amitraz toxicity in case of dogs and cat. Very commonly we use this Amitraz on dogs and cat. So more possibility that there will be accidental licking, or if you use more dosage, it might get absorbed from the dermal root if there is wound. So it might lead to these clinical signs. So you should have some concentration on this clinical sign. So there will be sedation, incoordination, ataxia, disorientation, anorexia, vomition, diarrhea, hypothermia, and there will be bradycardia, hypotension. So you know why bradycardia and hypotension? It is due to the decreased sympathetic outflow. And in dogs and cat, additionally, you get abdominal distension, abnormal response to the light, and there will be mydriasis. So apart from the above sign, there will be prominent intestinal colic in case of equine. So that's the reason why this Amitraz is not preferred in the equine. the normal dosage what we use on the equine will also cause intestinal colic. So that's the reason why it is indeed contraindicated in case of equines, Amitras. Postmortem finding, non-specific postmortem finding. Then the history, it is a diagnosis based on the history. So history should be very important. Then the clinical sign and the detection of Amitras in the liver, kidney, skin and the brain. So what will be the treatment? The treatment, obviously, it will be counteracting the action of Amitras on the alpha 2 receptor. So we have to use alpha 2 receptor antagonist. So it is the preferred alpha 2 receptor antagonist, Yohimbine or the atipamezole. So where else we use this Yohimbine or atipamezole? Whenever there is xylazine toxicity, its action is also through agonism of alpha 2 receptor. So the dosage of atipamezole in all species, it is 50 microgram per kg body weight IM. Yohimbine, it will be available in the government dispensaries. In district government hospital, you get this Yohimbine. So in dogs, there will be 0.1 milligram per kg body weight slow IV. In cattle, 0.125 milligram per kg body weight slow IV. Then activated charcoal, saline purgatives and dermal wash we have to do as a preventive measure you have to do. Then assignment question for this Amitras toxicity, name three brand names commonly used. You might be knowing two brand names and additionally you have to write the another brand name for Amitras. So what is the difference between the Amitras and ivermectin mechanism of action? So I hope the ivermectin will also be covered in the chemotherapy. If not covered, after going through the ectoparasiticide topic, you write this assignment. Then alpha 2 receptor agonist activity is seen in dash insecticide toxicity. Okay, so you cannot write xylazine here, so I am telling it as dash insecticide toxicity. Okay, so this assignment question for the Amitras toxicity. And the next topic is neonicotinoid insecticide are also called as chloronicotinoids. Neonicotinoid insecticide also called as chloronicotinoids. So among this group of insecticide, the very important prototype insecticide is imidacloprid. So imidacloprid is also commonly used ectoparasiticide. So earlier it was used in agriculture, but now it is very commonly used as an ectoparasiticide in case of animals. So it is very toxic to the birds, preferably to the house sparrow, quails, canaries and the pigeons. Apart from that, it is highly toxic to the bees as well. So because of toxicity to the bees, in western countries, they stopped using this imidacloprid. So there is a colony collapse disorder was very commonly seen in case of bees. So there is a decrease in the formation of colonies whenever they use imidacloprid on the plants. So there will be decreased colony formation from the bees, and the bee population drastically, it was decreased in the western countries. So as a reason, they stopped using this imidacloprid. But in India, as you know, it will be continued. So imidacloprid, no accumulation inside the body, so it is having fair metabolism, fair excretion. Then the mechanism of action, why it is called as chloronicotinoids? It is to do with its mechanism of action. It binds to and blocks the nicotinic cholinergic receptor. So what are the nicotinic cholinergic receptor? You get NM and NN type. So it's an antagonist of the nicotinic receptor. And this imidacloprid, it is having more selectivity on the pest rather than mammals. So the mammalian toxicity due to imidacloprid, it is very rare unless it is used in higher concentration. Unless it is used in higher concentration, it does not cause mammalian toxicity. Whatever the mechanism of action, it is on the pests, it is on the insects. So if it is used in the highest concentration, the same mechanism of action will be continued to the mammal, and the mammal is going to suffer from the imidacloprid toxicity. So what are the clinical signs? The clinical signs, it is to do with its action on the nicotinic receptor. So there will be muscle twitching, tremors, incoordination, behavioral changes, transient salivation. And in the birds, there will be ataxia, diarrhea, abnormal behavior, inability to fly. And there will be axial thinning, decreased egg production and decreased hatchability. And postmortem findings, there is a non-specific postmortem finding. And the diagnosis, it is mainly based on history and the clinical sign. And the treatment, you have to give muscle relaxant and the ganglionic blocker. Since it acts on the NM and NN, so muscle relaxant and ganglionic blockers are the treatment. So both, very rarely we use this muscle relaxant or ganglionic blocker, since side effects are more attached to these drugs. Generally symptomatic therapy are more preferred, so you can go for emetics, saline purgatives and also activated charcoal. So note, I told you it's having some ecological problems on the bee population and birds population. So bee population very commonly suffer with colony collapse disorder. The colony formation in case of bees, it will be very much drastically decreased due to the activity of the imidacloprid. Okay, so the assignment question: after blocking the nicotinic receptor, why salivation is seen in case of the imidacloprid toxicity? So think and answer this question. Okay, you can write it in the comment section only. And the last insecticide group is the natural products that we are going to see. So the last group of insecticides are the natural products. So which are the natural products commonly used as ectoparasiticide? Rotenone and the nicotine. So rotenone, it is a natural product obtained from the roots of the genus Deris elliptica and Deris chinensis plant. And this topic, it's an exam sec. Rotenone is an exam sec, very rarely used as an ectoparasiticide. When we have so much of available insecticide, why to go for rotenone, right? So earlier it was smeared on the arrowhead and used to catch the fishes. See, have you seen the advertisement of Fevistik? So the advertisement of Fevistik, they used to glue this Fevistik on the tip of the arrowhead. So you will keep it in the water source, then catch the fish. So similarly, you think of this adding of rotenone instead of this Fevistik. So the smear it on the arrowhead, so they used to catch the fishes. Because it is a very commonly used spicicide. So it is a very commonly used spicicide. It used to kill fishes very easily. But nowadays it is used as an ectoparasiticide to kill ticks, mites and the fleas. So rotenone in the body metabolized in the liver to the rotenoids, and rotenoids are also equally toxic. So what are the mechanism of action of rotenone? Rotenone mechanism of action is it inhibits electron transport chain. You know it is involved in the production of ATP. When there is inhibition of electron transport chain, there will be decrease in the ATP production, and it also inhibits the mitosis process. So clinical signs, obviously it is to related with the decreased ATP production. There will be omission, dyspnea, weakness, lethargy, ataxia, CNS seizure, CNS dysfunction, sedation and cardiovascular collapse will be there. Treatment, only symptomatic treatment, and another thing is you have to maintain the vital functions in the body. So it is the important thing about rotenone. The important thing about rotenone is it is used as a spicicide and its mechanism of action, and it is an extract obtained from the roots of Deris elliptica, Deris chinensis. And another natural product that we are going to discuss is the nicotine. So nicotine, it is a liquid alkaloid obtained from the leaves of Nicotiana tobacum. So you might get surprised. So it is a liquid alkaloid, nicotine. Really, you might have asked this. So is it a liquid alkaloid? Because it is incorporated in the cigarette, so we used to inhale it. So how come it is a liquid alkaloid? So it is a, basically it is a liquid alkaloid which is volatile in nature. So it is a liquid alkaloid obtained from leaves of Nicotiana tobacum. And this Nicotiana tobacum plants, it is very commonly grown around Ramnathpura areas in the Arkalgod and also in Periyapatna and those surrounding areas. So the tobacco plant is very commonly grown. So the toxicity will be commonly seen in those areas also. And this nicotine, it is a potent poison. So it is used as an anthelmintic. Occasionally this nicotine is also used as immobilizing agent. So it is used as an immobilizing agent for aggressive animal by darting. So by a type of gun, carbon dioxide boosting gun, so they used to inject this nicotine so to immobilize the aggressive animal. Very occasionally they use this nicotine. And other sources is, you know, by smoking, by chewing, there will be nicotine toxicity. In animals, what are the chances of nicotine toxicity? See, nicotine very commonly used as an ingredient of black leaf 40, which is used as an insecticide, which contain 40% of nicotine sulfate, which is used as an insecticide. Accidental licking of such insecticide might cause nicotine toxicity. That is one thing. And the leftover cigarette butts, see, the human beings, they used to inhale, they used to smoke, and they leave the cigarette butts
like that only, and accidentally these cigarette butts eaten by dogs and cat. So it will lead to nicotine toxicity. A one pack of cigarette pack can kill a dog. So that will be the accidental ingestion. And another thing, the plant, say the ruminants, they might get access to the tobacco plant. See, tobacco plants, they used to dry this tobacco plant in a house. So accidentally, if it get access to such tobacco plant, or in pasture only, if it get access to a tobacco plant. Generally, tobacco plant, they are unpalatable in nature. So they are generally unpalatable. They don't eat this tobacco plant. But whenever there is scarcity, whenever there is drought, they are pushed to eat this tobacco plant. That time it will cause tobacco toxicity. So many cases have been reported in these areas due to ingestion of the tobacco plant. And chemically, tobacco is called as 3-1-methyl-2-pyrrolidyl-pyridine. Then sources, you know, accidental ingestion, the licking and the leaf from leaves, from tobacco bales. And when immobilizing the animal, if you use increased dosage, it causes nicotine toxicity. And in cigarette, it contains 20 milligram of nicotine. Cigarette butt contain 5 milligram. Chewing contain 2.5 to 8 milligram per gram dry material. So a pack of cigarette, it is lethal to a dog. So dog, of course, when it eat only, it causes cigarette toxicity. You don't smoke. Then toxicokinetics of nicotine. So it is enter through oral, dermal and inhalation route. So from acidic environment, the absorption of nicotine is very poor. That means from stomach, the absorption of nicotine is very poor. So it will get absorbed from the small intestine only. From alkaline area only, it has to get absorbed. So from the blood, it will enter the brain and do its toxic effect. It will be metabolized in the liver, and the metabolites are cotinine and nor-nicotine, which will be excreted through the urine. Then the mechanism of action of nicotine. So I think it's already been described. So again, we are going to see about the mechanism of action of nicotine. So nicotine, what is its primary mechanism of action? It binds to the nicotinic cholinergic receptor. So where you see nicotinic cholinergic receptor? You see nicotinic cholinergic receptor at the neuromuscular junction. The type is NM. At the autonomic ganglion, you see the type NN. So apart from this, the two other places are, it is also seen in the adrenal medulla, which will lead to the NN. So it will lead to the release of the adrenaline, right? So in the CNS also, you will see the NN type of nicotinic cholinergic receptor. So these are the place where you see the nicotinic cholinergic receptor. So what will be its action? See, there will be initial stimulation. See, that's what happen when a smoker smoke. So there will be initial stimulation. So followed by depolarizing type of blockage of all the target organs. So initially stimulation, then there will be depression. So what actually happened in the nicotine toxicity? See, prolonged agonist action. See, whenever there is prolonged agonist action, whenever there is presence of prolonged agonistic action on a receptor, so what will happen? When there is continuous presence of agonist in the surrounding of the receptor, it will obviously causes desensitization. So when there is desensitization, there will be initial stimulation followed by the depression. The reason being desensitization, or we call it as tachyphylaxis. So under tachyphylaxis, the classical example what we give for tachyphylaxis is smoking. So that's the reason. Due to desensitization, there will be tachyphylaxis. And we are going to see here, see, there will be initial activation of the nicotinic receptor on the autonomic ganglion. On the autonomic ganglion, what exactly will happen? So autonomic ganglion, so if this is the preganglionic neuron, so this is the preganglionic neuron. So preganglionic neuron receptor is NN type. And the postganglionic neuron, innervates on the target organ. See, if it is parasympathetic nervous system, then the neurotransmitter released from preganglionic neuron will be acetylcholine. From postganglionic neuron will be acetylcholine. See, what will happen here? So when there is nicotine toxicity, nicotine will act on the NN receptor. Initially, there will be stimulation. So what do you mean by stimulation? It stimulates the postganglionic neuron to increase the release of acetylcholine. So acetylcholine will act on the target organ. So afterwards, after a stimulation period, there will be depression period. So continuous presence of nicotine there. So there will be desensitization. So NN won't work. So there will be depression. So it will decrease the release of acetylcholine at this synapse. So as a result, it will depress the acetylcholine release from postganglionic neuron also. So there will be decrease in the acetylcholine. So initially there will be increase in the acetylcholine release, then there will be decrease in the acetylcholine release. That science will be similar to this.
Suppose this is sympathetic nervous system. So if there is sympathetic nervous system, the neurotransmitter released from the preganglionic neuron is acetylcholine. From the postganglionic neuron, it will be noradrenaline. So initially, acetylcholine will be increased release. So as a result, the noradrenaline will be increased stimulation. So this is the reason why you see CNS stimulation, increased CNS stimulation in the CNS. It is mainly due to the release of this noradrenaline in the CNS. So later, as the time progresses, the acetylcholine level will be decreased here. So as a result, the noradrenaline level will also be decreased. So as a result, the clinical signs attributed to this is mainly due to the decrease in the noradrenaline release as the time progresses. The same thing has been explained here. So releases neurotransmitter, both noradrenaline, acetylcholine, intense stimulates the parasympathetic and sympathetic activation. Then there will be subsequent blockade of the parasympathetic nervous system, sympathetic nervous system. See, for example, see what are the effects of acetylcholine on the target organ? It causes salivation, it causes bradycardia, it causes diarrhea. So what will happen after time progresses? It will decrease the salivation, it will cause constipation, there will be tachycardia. So there will be reversal, okay? So similarly, the second one, NM receptor, it is on the skeletal muscle end plate. So skeletal muscle end plate also, there will be initial stimulation, then there will be depression. Similarly, on the adrenal medulla, initially it will increase the release of adrenaline and noradrenaline, then there will be decrease in the release of noradrenaline and adrenaline. So that will be the action of nicotine. So did you understand? The nicotine action, in a nutshell, there will be initial stimulation followed by a depolarizing type of blockade, mainly due to the phenomenon called as tachyphylaxis due to the desensitization of the receptor. So what are the clinical signs? So similarly, we will see the clinical sign. There will be initial stimulation followed by blockade of CNS stimulation. Then there will be depression, excitement, rapid respiration, salivation, lacrimation, vomition, and diarrhea. And you find clonic tonic type of convulsion, muscle weakness, incoordination, flaccid paralysis, death due to respiratory paralysis. So if there is chronic toxicity, you might see teratogenic defect, especially in case of eaves which eat tobacco plant, it might suffer from cleft palate. The next generation will suffer from cleft palate. Postmortem finding, pale mucous membrane, dull colored blood, hemorrhage in the heart and the lungs, stomach content, you might smell nicotinic odor, and there might be possibility that you find cigarette butts, you might find the remnants of tobacco plant in the ruminal content. Diagnosis, history, clinical sign, chemical analysis, then urine content of the metabolite cotinine, it's a confirmatory diagnosis for nicotine toxicity. And initial signs of overstimulation of cholinergic receptor. See, initial stimulation, I told you, NN receptor in the parasympathetic nervous system. So it will increase the release of acetylcholine. And this signs is very much similar to the organophosphorus poisoning. So important differential diagnosis. Then the treatment, during early stages, you can go for non-depolarizing ganglionic blocker like mecmilamine only during early stage. Once it passed the early stage, there will be reversal of the early stage signs. So very careful while using mecmilamine. You can use adsorbent, and why we have to use atropine sulfate? If there is parasympathetic clinical signs, you can go for atropine sulfate only initially, then fluid therapy. So you should not go for antacids. Why we should not go for antacids? It gets better absorbed from the alkaline environment. And the other treatment you can use is, you can go for urinary acidifier also. You can go for urinary acidifier, decreases the reabsorption, increases the excretion of the nicotine metabolites. In the assignment question, so carefully think and answer. Nicotine acts on the muscarinic receptor to bring about the salivation, true or false? So if true, justify. If false, you justify the answer. Then the atropine is used in the treatment of nicotine toxicity, true or false? Atropine can be used in the treatment of nicotine toxicity, true or false? You justify the answer if true or if false, okay? So this is about insecticide. So from the next class, we will start rodenticides, okay? Thank you.